we can go on with Jan-Piet and talk about monitoring with MQTT.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jan-Piet, or JP as I'm often referred to. I would like to, excuse me. I would like to this afternoon tell you a little bit about MQTT. And MQTT is basically a protocol for the IoT, for the Internet of Things. Can everybody hear me properly, loudly enough? Thank you. And I see quite a lot of benefit for using MQTT for, well, what I'm more or less a little bit at least of an expert on, and that is everything to do with system administration, monitoring, things like that. So let's dig in. MQTT used to be an acronym, and it is not anymore. MQTT is a standard. It's a TCP/IP-based transport protocol based on pub/sub, publish/subscribe messaging. And MQTT was originally designed by IBM about 10 years ago for unreliable networks, things like mobile networks, which are extremely unreliable. When you and I take out a smartphone, and we're standing at a station somewhere and want something, then we normally have a connection. But if you think of this phone that travels through 3G, 2G, 4G, wireless, on, off, and so on, that is what we term unreliable networks. And for that, it's particularly well suited. By the way, this dessert here, this white chocolate sauce on the right, is there because it's called 1883. And 1883 is the designated TCP/IP port number for MQTT. So, MQTT is a transport protocol. It supports binary payloads of up to 256 megabytes, has a 2-byte overhead on a packet. MQTT is very fast, it's very lightweight, ideal for low bandwidth, high latency networks, and also for very, very small devices. And if you pardon my nervosity, I'm very nervous because I have here something I've prepared for you, a live demo with a small Arduino clone, which is running MQTT. I won't touch it now. I'll show you later on. So MQTT runs on almost anything. MQTT offers security to a certain extent. First of all, TLS, the artist that about 20 years ago was known as SSL. MQTT supports authentication with username, password. MQTT supports, on the server side, ACLs, access control lists, of course, who is allowed to do what. Certain implementations support TLS PSK, which is very, very interesting, pre-shared key over TLS. Currently, the only system known to me that does that is the Mosquito Broker, which I'll introduce in a second, and C. And of course, you have, since we have binary payloads, you can do any form of payload encryption yourself. Obviously. MQTT supports three different so-called QoS, or quality of service. Quality of service 0, 1, and 2. Quality of zero, QoS 0 means publish at most once. So a publisher will fire off a message, and it will get to its destination. The destination is an MQTT server at most once, possibly 0 times. Okay, so you might have loss. That sounds strange, but that's perfectly normal. If you think, use MQTT, for example, for monitoring, host load, or so on, every couple seconds, it doesn't really matter if one measurement gets lost. The next one will be coming in very soon. Assured delivery, quality of service 1, means it will get there at least once. It might get there 2 or 3 times, but at least once. And QoS 2 means once only, and that means that the transport mechanism, MQTT protocol, guarantees that your publish will arrive exactly once. Okay. As you see from the yellow arrows, of course, the higher the QoS, the more traffic we are going to produce. So depending on the use case for MQTT, you will make a hopefully judicious choice of the QoS that you want to support. There are a number of exciting, or at least I find at least exciting, features that MQTT has. First of all, a keep alive, which will, above the TCP level, ensure that MQTT connection between client and server, that both parties always know whether this connection is still active. Second of all, a last will and testament. Last will and testament, that's what clever people create when they are still able to do so. It means what happens if I die. And an MQTT client can publish what is called a last will and testament. And this means, dear MQTT server, in the case of my death, for whichever reason, in other words, if I drop off the network, for whichever reason, please, on my behalf, publish this to all my subscribers. That allows us, and I hope I will be able to show you live, that allows us to do things like host monitoring with MQTT. If the connection drops, for example, host goes down, Ethernet connection fails, whatever, power failure, etc., the MQTT broker will, on the behalf of that client, publish this death. This publish could be an integer value, 0, 1, went offline. Could be a whole JSON payload, could be 256 megabytes if you want, okay? On any topic, on any address, I'll show you in a moment, that you define. MQTT allows, through this publish subscribe mechanism, the decoupling of senders and receivers. So here on the bottom left, we have a publisher, and we have a number of subscribers. And at any moment, we can have additional subscribers. Subscribers can drop off. An MQTT message that is published will be published via a server, via an MQTT broker, to all subscribers of that particular, who are interested in messages of that particular type. And MQTT knows something that is called durable messages or retained messages. And that is a little bit like the last known good value. Think, for example, a weather station that reports once an hour, it reports current temperature outside. Yeah? Or even this little thing, which will be reporting temperature. We can publish, or this client can publish the value retained. That means if you are interested in finding out what is the weather in Nuremberg like, it is okay if you get the last value that was published, let's say, 58 minutes ago. If a message is not retained, new subscribers to this message topic will only get the next message the next time it's published. Whereas if we have retained messages, which are held, which are retained, which are made durable by the MQTT broker, then a subscriber will get that last known good value, and then subsequently anything that is that will be published to it. I've already alluded to this or mentioned it. Messages are published to topics. A topic is a hierarchical UTF-8 string. It is limited to 64, 65 kilobytes in length and may, on the side of a subscriber, contain wildcards. So, for example, we could have a device publishing to a topic called temperature slash room slash living. Or we could have, let's say, an Arduino or some host publishing to devices slash host name slash CPU slash load. Okay? On the subscriber side, we can have wildcards. A hash symbol stands for any amount of levels, and a plus symbol stands for exactly one level. So a subscriber who's subscribing to finance slash plus slash euro slash rate would get any messages that are being published, as long as it's allowed to get these, it would get any messages that are being published to finance slash IBM slash euro rate or Yahoo or Google or whatever. Okay? And any combination of wildcards, more or less any combination of wildcards, is allowed. In pub-sub systems, publish-subscribe systems, I see this like a cauldron, like a big pot of boiling whatever, and messages are being added by different clients into this cauldron, and subscribers can, if they are allowed to, take out any messages. So, for example, we have a client that is publishing temperature as a numeric Celsius value, but you have some application that would like this as a Fahrenheit value. You can write a tiny little program that will subscribe to the Celsius value, sort of take it out, read it out, convert it to Fahrenheit, and push it back in under a different topic. Okay. Any amount of Why is this not full screen anymore? Any amount of subscribers, any amount of publishers can connect to a single MQTT server. And this MQTT server is called a broker. Basically, it's more or less small piece of software which sits somewhere on your network. And there's a broker and has a number of clients, publishers, and subscribers who speak MQTT with this broker. I beg your pardon. And there are at least two very well-known brokers. One of them is called Mosquito. Note the double T. I understand the reason was it is an interesting word with MQTT in it. Mosquito is an open source project driven by a man called Roger Light. It's written in C, it's very fast, lightweight, contains support for ACLs, for access control lists, also with plugins you can add, has support for TLS, transport layer security, TLS PSK, can do bridging. I'll talk about bridging in a second. Starting with version 1.4, which ought to be coming out relatively soon, will support WebSockets. I'll show you that in a moment. And also logs via a special $sys topic. I'll show you in a second. Another interesting project is Hive MQ. This is not open source. This is a commercial broker written in Java. If I recall correctly, it's free to use with so and so many clients. As I said, it's written in Java, has a number of plugins, also was one of the first to support WebSockets, allows clustering, you can add your own modules, etc. Then there are things like products like IBM Message Site, which cost I don't know how many thousands of dollars, which are brokers sort of in hardware, which would do, I understand, somewhere around 15 million messages, pub subs per second. So that's quite heavy, heavyweight stuff. I mentioned logging to $sys. $sys is a special topic which is sort of reserved for brokers to publish statistics. So the Mosquito broker, for example, will periodically, every few seconds, publish to these topic, to the $sys topic, $sys broker clients total, the number of total connected clients. Or, for example, $sys broker bytes received, so and so many octets, so and so many bytes received, so and so many bytes sent. This is a Mosquito version, $ broker. Version is Mosquito version 1.4. Messages received, messages sent, huge number of different statistics, which can be consumed, for example, by monitoring software. If you have any questions in between, please just shout. Gladly accept them. Right, bridging. Bridging is a possibility to hook up or connect or interconnect two distinct brokers. For example, in one data center, you could have an MQTT broker with clients who publish and subscribe to that. And certain topics you can map, or you can pass on, you can bridge on to a second MQTT broker somewhere in a second data center. During this bridging process, we can also rename topics. So instead of, or here we have client publishing to temperature/Celsius, and here you want it as Temperatur, the German word, /Celsius. This remapping, this renaming of topics can be done on the fly with Mosquito, for example. This allows a number of clients to be off-site in a second data center, and you just have one single, for example, one single TCP connection to a centralized broker. Okay. Utilities. The two utilities, Mosquito Sub, Mosquito Pub, which command line tools which belong to the Mosquito project, which allow us from the command line to subscribe to topics and also to publish. Now, they have a huge amount of options, for example, port, host name. You can specify certificates, certificate files, key files, etc., username, password, TLS versions. Mosquito Sub, in its simplest form, you should use -v, which will show you the topic name, and then you specify with -t the topic branch you are interested in, either a full topic or a number of full topics, or using wildcards. And conversely, to publish, we have Mosquito Pub, which expects, at the very least, a topic and a payload. Okay. The -r switch for Mosquito Pub indicates to the broker, please retain this publication. Please keep it for me. Please make it durable for subsequent clients. MQTT is available in all languages, bindings for any language, C, Python, JavaScript, Perl, Ruby, etc., Lua, whatever you want, and can be very, very easily implemented. Here's my favorite scripting language du jour, so Python. Here's an example. We have an import of the PAHO MQTT module, and I can fire off just a single publish by specifying a topic and a payload. Okay, and if at the same time we had a client subscribed to that topic conf/hash, remember we're publishing to conf/hello, then this client would receive this publish with this string. Conversely, the publishing subscribing side in Python is a little bit more complex because messages can sort of show up at any moment. So we define callbacks, and these callbacks are invoked, for example, on connect or on log or on message when a message is accepted, or on publish when our own program publishes a message. We can invoke a callback which is also called, etc. I'll leave that out. So where is MQTT used? MQTT is used in a bunch of applications for alerting, for metering, for example, smart meters, for logging. Our friends at Greylog have added, here's Bernd in front, have added an MQTT subscriber to Greylog 2. Yeah, very, very nice. Location awareness, tracking. Talk to me, not now, later, about our own tracks project. Here's a screenshot of me approaching Brighton. This is, in this case, an iOS app. We have the same for Android, which uses MQTT to publish current location. For automation, for controlling, for host monitoring, one very interesting project, at least I thought it was very interesting, the Deutsche Bahn has very recently replaced in, I think, 7,000, no, in several thousand German railway stations, in the small ones, you have these, wie heißen die Dinger? Anzeigetafel, these little boards showing train is delayed or train is going to arrive in 5 minutes or train departs. So this single line of yellow LEDs in a blue enclosure. Reiseinformationssystem. It even has a name. Excuse me, just a second. And these used to be fed via SMS, via short messages. Cost a fortune. And they have very, very recently been replaced by different hardware, which is now powered via MQTT. So when you are standing on one of the stations at one of those Reiseinformationssystem displays, the ones with a single yellow line in it, and you see train arriving in 10 minutes, that message got there via MQTT. You have a question?
I was also working for a banking system, and they were using this kind of stuff for transactions and so on.
That will probably, not necessarily, but probably be AMQP, probably not MQTT.
Yeah, sure. So it's the concept of this. So they were actually using WebSphere MQ.
Okay, WebSphere MQ is similar in concept, of course, but there you have really a queue. So
yeah,
things that are published will be sucked out on the other end when the subscriber gets there. Yeah. With MQTT, and maybe I didn't underline that carefully enough, with MQTT, if you have a subscriber subscribed to one or more topics, endless amount of topics, if that subscriber dies, isn't there, at the moment the message is published, then that particular subscriber will never get that message unless it was retained. Yeah? So if you have a subscriber, if you have in an MQTT environment, if you have a bunch of subscribers, if they are not listening, subscribed to a particular topic at that moment, they will not see those messages. Okay? That is on purpose. Thank you. So there are quite a number. Things like hospital monitoring and so on. Also, the projects with MQTT, quite a number of real-life scenarios for MQTT. One other real-life thing is a small project we started called MQTT Warn. We suddenly realized that people were writing, left, right, and center, were writing subscribers, subscribe to MQTT and publish on Twitter, and subscribe to this and publish on Prowl, and subscribe to this and publish via Growl, and subscribe to this. And we thought, why don't we try and do this properly? And what we created is called MQTT Warn, and MQTT Warn is nothing else but a high-flying little program that subscribes to an MQTT broker, to any number of topics that you desire, and has a bunch of plugins on the other side. At last count, I think there were 35 or 38 or something plugins for different services. And with a hopefully relatively simple configuration language in an ini file, you say, well, anything that is published on home/alerts, if you do home automation, for example, should be sent to the pushover and should be sent to XBMC, displayed on the TV, in case you're sitting in front of a television set. Whereas anything that is published on monitoring /anything/hash should be sent to Twitter, to probably to a secret account, and should be published via SMTP as an email to somebody. Okay, so MQTT Warn, a rather flexible tool that we created. There's the address. It's on github.com under my repository. One of the plugins we created is an SCA, which will fire off data to Icinga, Nagios, via an SCA. An SCA stands for Nagios Control. What does NSCA stand for? Who knows? Nagios Control something automation. I can't remember what it's called, sorry. And and the reason I'm telling you about this is sort of real life. People do a lot of stuff with this, and it belongs sort of in this chapter, no? Practical solutions. And the reason I've put it there is I would like to show you something, and I hope it works. And what I've brought along is an Arduino clone. That's this thing here. It's tiny, smaller than a pack of cigarettes, and it's connected via Ethernet. And I'm going to sort of demonstrate the temperature sensor that you might have in a server rack or in a DC, or some people have dozens of these things in a data center. Now, you might wonder, well, what the hell is this? Now, this is my sort of simulated temperature. I want to show you that temperature rises and falls. And I don't want you to all light a cigarette or something, but so I'll just use a potentiometer to simulate temperature going up and down. And in addition, connected to this thing is a little buzzer and a green LED. Okay, so that's what's lying here. And it's powered on. Let me just say, yeah, it's powered on. And by rights, once in a while, I'm going to press enter here. By rights, we should be, every few seconds, receiving a publish from this Arduino. Now, this Arduino is publishing to this topic. Cool. That's high tech, huh? So when I press the red laser button, you get the escape sequence there. It really goes to show, there's not enough that you can test. No? So it's publishing to this topic. I won't use the laser pointer now. I'll use my finger here. Clients, Arduino, then its IP address, 10.0.69.105, Celsius, and then an integer value, okay, 17. So my temperature thing is now on 17. Now, if I change the temperature by mucking about, nobody has a camera, no? On my little potentiometer here, and I'll just swirl it to the left and to the right. These are MQTT publishes coming out here, okay? So I'll put it somewhere around 25. 23. So you see, I can almost not turn it fast enough. There's no lag at all. No? So pretty fast. And simultaneously, I'm very nervous, my first live demo ever. Simultaneously, by rights anyway, this web page will also be not displaying the temperature, will also be displaying the temperature. And this web page is basically a static web page with a few JavaScript gimmicks, and it connects via MQTT over web sockets to the same broker. It's all the same thing. It's speaking MQTT to the same broker that we saw here, okay? So same values. But it's speaking WebSockets. So it's reading MQTT and publishing MQTT over WebSockets. So if I twirl here, then that little thing on the left turns, the thing on the top turns, you have all sorts of stuff turning and fiddling there, okay? Right. Now, MQTT is, if I want, bidirectional. I can have a device that publishes, but that same device can also subscribe and receive commands. This little Arduino simultaneously is subscribing to an MQTT topic. And if all goes well, and if I press this little button, this little red button here, the following thing will happen. This JavaScript page will publish, to a certain topic, command beep. The Arduino will receive that, will do something with it, in this case, I hope beep, and will report back a status on a different topic. And the status will result, if everything goes well, in that little button changing color. And at the same time, of course, the Arduino should then light up this LED. Okay? Fascinating, huh? And you can... No, I'm only half kidding. Now, I'm going to hit return here a couple times. Just a moment. Let me try and place this in such a way that you can see both. So I'm going to hit return here a couple times. And then we'll look at the publishers that come out. So the first publish that came out was a publish to client Arduino LED command, please turn on, and then came back. Supposedly, I mean, I know, from the Arduino, LED is now on. Okay? It's very important when you're driving little stuff, little things, not only to tell them to go on, but also to receive a feedback, yeah, I now went on. Okay? Imagine you're somewhere out in the pits, let's say Nuremberg, and you switch on the heating at home. You say on, but did it actually go on or not? You want a feedback, okay? So with MQTT, we can publish, subscribe this back. Now, don't get me wrong, please. I'm showing you this on a tiny little device, just sort of to show you with a tiny little device. But this is also very, very interesting for things like controlling stuff in a data center, controlling processes, etc. A whole bunch of applications that are possible. Don't get me started. Right, so that was number one. Now, I will stop the subscriber here, and I will start second subscriber, and that is MQTT warn. And MQTT warn will now do exactly the same thing. It's receiving temperature, and what we're seeing here is it publishing what it's currently receiving, okay? Just logs here on standard out, well, in a log file, current temperature, 20C. It's the same 20 that it was getting here, but it's now reformatted into a little bit nicer text. And simultaneously, it is, I hope, sending this information down to an Icinga 1 instance. So, by rights, if I change the temperature, it takes a bit because NSCA is a very slow protocol, by rights, Please. This should, you probably notice here the temperature changing here. Ah, look, critical. It worked. My first demo. So MQTT warn is reading, it's just this app is reading or subscribing to a topic, modifying the temperature, and sending it off. Okay. Let's, for example, do one thing. Let's stop this, and I'll change now the configuration here a bit, and I'll add an additional target, and I will restart MQTT warn. This is one of the very important plugins that we have in MQTT warn.
Current temperature, 29
C. Can you hear it? As a mic? Can everybody hear it?
Yeah.
Current temperature, 29 C.
Not true.
Current temperature, 28 C.
Yeah.
Current temperature, 27 C.
Oh, shut up. So I had to kill it, and it got stuck somewhere. So we are able to, with one single publisher, one single source of information, some little tuppence halfpenny temperature sensor stuck in some server rack, we are able to take this data, send it out by mail, we can send it down to Nagios, well, to Icinga in this case, Icinga 1, do all sorts of things, okay? One important thing I now still want to show you, and that is, let me go back to this subscriber. Now, I had said to you that one very exciting feature of MQTT is the last will and testament. Now, this little Arduino thing, this little MQTT client, when it started up, it sent out a last will and testament to the broker and said to the broker, please, in the case of my death, in other words, you don't see me anymore, for whatever reason, it can be my power went off, my network connection died, whatever. Yeah. In the case of my death, please publish this information for me. Now, if all goes well, and it ought to go well, if all goes well, when I pull the plug, we'll see the following thing happen. Obviously, the publishing of the temperature will stop because the damn thing has died. And a few seconds later, actually, time modulo keep alive, which I think I've set to 60 seconds. A few seconds later, we should see one last publish coming out. And this one last publish will be, if I recall correctly, it's the topic slash zero or something, payload zero. And that is the information one or zero. Yeah, I'm alive or I'm not alive. And at that instance, please also watch the green thing at the top right. So what I'm just going to do now is pull the plug. It's now not powered anymore, okay? So we're still getting let me hit enter. We're still getting, okay, now not anymore. We're not getting temperature anymore. The broker is still, the MQTT broker is still trying to talk to the Arduino, to this one client. And after a few seconds, it decides that client must have gone because it's not pinging me anymore. It's not doing MQTT pings anymore. Yeah, no more ping requests anymore. And at that instant, it publishes, the broker, on behalf of the client who is no longer there, publishes the original last will and testament. This original last will and testament, that's the way I defined it, has a payload, well, has a topic, of course, and a payload of just zero. Because I defined this as being when that payload is one, the device is on. When the payload is zero, the device is off. And of course, the web thing, the WebSocket thing got that also, and then I just flick the status to red. Now, let's suppose we start over, and this client resubscribes to the topic branch. Why do I suddenly get three messages shown to me? They are retained, okay? The client has published them in a retained form. So when a client subscribes to this branch In other words, how is the temperature sensor in my data center, shack, rack two, shelf, whatever, doing? The first information it gets is it's offline. But the last temperature published was 26. And this, of course, is idiotic. If it were on, the LED would be now be one. Yeah, but it isn't. Okay, so that's the benefit of retained messages. We can, even though the device has actually gone away for a while, we can determine, thanks to the MQTT retained messages, we can determine what was the last good value that was published by that device. Okay. I'll plug it in again. And by rights, it should come up. And by rights, also, one of the first things that will happen is it will publish itself a payload of one at this topic here. So it will say, I am online. It takes 5, 6, 7, 10 seconds, sorry, for an Arduino to come up. There it comes. Now, I said to you, it is idiotic that the LED is indicated as one. It depends on the application. It's not idiotic. Remember, I pulled the plug, right? And then I put it back in again. Why is this LED on? Because the Arduino, this client, the first thing it did after connection is subscribe to that topic and determine what state should my LED be in. Should it be on or off? Okay. Right, good. I'm losing my something.
Happens if in this time, so the client dies, actually your host dies, and the broker dies also. So the client dies, send the will and the testament, okay, the broker knows, then the broker dies and the client comes back. Is
well, if the client comes back,
yeah,
to a dead broker, the client is, of course, dead because it cannot connect to this broker, okay? So let's perhaps first answer the following question.
So the idea is if the status of the LED, let's say, changes when the broker is dead, the broker is going to set what state?
If we do things correctly, the status of the LED should not or must not change while the broker is not there.
Okay.
Yeah, obviously we can find a combination. I mean, it starts getting very difficult. No? If for example, this little device had a switch on it, please turn LED on, and we did that, and the broker wasn't there, then the LED would go on, but the broker wouldn't know. Yeah? So in a case like that, you have to carefully consider. It's sometimes very difficult. You have to carefully consider how should I structure my application.
So. All this logic has to be programmed in the daemon, in the broker. And yeah, that has to take care of.
Not
this.
In the broker. The broker does nothing. The broker is a very simple, well, simple in double quotes. The broker is a very simple program that does nothing else but receive publishes, checks ACLs, checks access control lists, and passes them on. That's all it does.
Okay.
There's no logic whatsoever in the broker itself.
Okay, so it's just
in terms of our applications.
Okay.
In this case, the logic is in the software
okay.
that I, in the firmware that I okay. created for this little device.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so that has to manage all the stuff that you want to use and how to use and so on. Okay.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Let me just flick back to the slides. Somewhere there. So that's the hardware setup, and we saw this. So how does this all work? Let me once again point out what we have here. We have a mosquito broker running here on this laptop. Actually, there's also a mosquito broker running on the little OpenWRT router that's on the floor, but it doesn't matter. Just saying, it's really a small piece of software. It runs in almost anything. So we have a mosquito broker running here, And this little device, this Arduino clone, is talking via MQTT to this broker, okay? And it's publishing on a topic that looks like this with a certain payload. I chose the payload to be a simple string denoting an integer. I could have published a JSON object with Celsius and Fahrenheit in it. That's up to the application designer to do it, okay? The web browser page is connected via WebSockets, MQTT over WebSockets to this same broker. So when the client here publishes something, it's directly published on to the web page. Conversely, when we press the little red button on the web page, that initiated a publish, and that publish went to the broker, and thus, because the Arduino was also listening to it, thus also to the Arduino, which then turned on the LED. And we had simultaneously running MQTT warn. This is a little Python program that subscribes to any number of topics and invokes plugins. This connection here is, of course, also over MQTT. And in this particular case, we had a plugin running, which was talking to Icinga. And this is then NSCA protocol, or NCSA, can't remember. NSCA protocol, which stands for whatever. Nagios service control check. Thank you. There it is. Check acceptor. Good, thank you. So that's the setup that you that we just saw here. Right, and in addition to that, we can then, for example, by having subscribers like a program like MQTT Warn, we can at any moment when we decide to do that, at any instance, we can add additional subscribers. So for example, if I wanted to keep track of the temperature in this case is probably not really fascinating because it's rather, hopefully a rather constant value, but suppose I wanted to, I could dock onto this he on the left, an instance of, for example, Greylog2 with an MQTT connector on it, input as it's officially called, and it would then take the messages and log them. Okay, any number of Greylog2 is great. Any number of MQTT and also, of course, other inputs can be configured to read these messages. At any time, we can add additional subscribers, which will then, from that moment on, consume these messages and do something with them. For example, this Nagios alert, I've lost my thing. This Nagios alert, you can't hear me anymore, no? Now you can. That we saw at the bottom of the screen there. Yeah, that's all very fine and dandy, but what do we do from there? I know customers who then buy themselves expensive SMS sending boxes, and they buy themselves special mail servers and so on to send alerts via email, etc. Why? Why don't we hook up the Nagios Icinga alerting, sorry, I forget the terminology, plugin, to also publish a state such as critical, etc., to MQTT, and from there, we can, for example, using the same program, MQTT Warn, send this over to, anybody recognize this? Send this over to Pushover. Pushover is a service that exists for Android phones, for web, for iOS phones. And in this case, it's red because MQTT Warn sent this over with a warning, and the operator then has to confirm this, acknowledge the report on his phone, yeah? And yeah, that's about it. Everything about MQTT you can find out at mqtt.org. There's a whole bunch of documents and web pages, etc. And keep in mind, I hope you keep in mind that MQTT is, on the one hand, might be very sexy for the Internet of Things, but on the other hand, has a certain, as I feel, very practical value for all things system administration, monitoring, hosts coming and going, and I hope to see more and more adoption of this in our world, in our world of Unix system administration. And I know, because we're talking about this at the moment, for example, to add an MQTT plugin to collect D. We just publish its metrics onto our MQTT bus, and anybody on the network, well, any authorized subscriber on the network, would be able to then do stuff with this. So we're able to, using MQTT and just this as sort of one communication channel, we're able to channel stuff and make things a little bit more more flexible and hopefully more resilient. Any questions? Yes, please.
One moment, please.
Excuse me.
So where was the question?
The critical part of the construction is the MQTT broker. So what are your concepts for backing up or making it always available?
You're quite right, and you have identified the point of failure. Well, basically, I don't have any sort of out-of-the-box solution for you. The reason I don't have any out-of-the-box solution is it depends very much on what, on which broker you use. So, for example, if you if you wanted commercial support, etc., and wanted to use Hive MQ, which is the Java broker, they have clustering support. Yeah. In the case of the open source Mosquito itself does not come with any solution for clustering, etc. Certainly not at this moment. What can we do? We can do things like load balancing, or put two behind a load balancer, things like that. The typical solutions to solve this kind of problem. Or you have a lot of money in your wallet, and then you could go the way of, for example, IBM message site, yeah, which is the really very high end scale of the thing. So for the open source Mosquito broker, the only sort of solutions would be put two more behind a load balancer of some sort. Have I answered your question? Not to your liking, but that's the only answer I have at the moment.
Is it possible for a client to connect to two brokers?
Oh yes, absolutely. You can connect. Absolutely, you can connect to any amount of brokers. Just down below, it's just a TCP connection. No? So yeah, you can, in one application, you can connect to any amount of brokers. In fact, this thing here, this client. Remember, this is just a stupid little client, no? It connects to this broker to subscribe to the topics you want. But here, out on the other side, one of the plugins we have is it's called probably MQTT or MQTT Pub. I forget. I wrote it myself, but I forget. And that can connect to any amount of brokers. So yes, one application can connect to any amount of brokers. Yeah. Depends a little on the client. If we're talking about an Arduino which has whatever 20 kilobytes of RAM, then please don't expect to handle payloads of 256 meg. Okay, so it all has. But in a normal client program, Python, C, whatever, no problem whatsoever. Yeah. So the question is, how did I manage the authentication in my example? That is a very simple answer, not at all. Okay? So, in this particular case, this application runs in a contained network, which I trust or don't trust, whatever. This client does not authenticate. It could. So, for example, the code that exists, there's a library written by a chap called Nick O'Leary, I think. I think it was Nick. O'Leary, in any case. The library has code for doing authentication. And you would have to specify here username and a password, which is, of course, then sort of more or less burnt into the firmware. No? And on the other side, on the Mosquito side, for example, other brokers are different, but on the Mosquito side, you have a password file, which contains a username and an encrypted password, or you can either create an authentication plugin which uses some other data source. I have written one called Mosquito Auth Plug, which is relatively successful, which can use MySQL or PostgreSQL or Redis or LDAP, or somebody sent me a pull request recently for a REST interface. So it has a number. This authentication plugin, which is sort of dynamically linked to Mosquito, can have any number of backends which actually do then the authentication and authorization. Yeah? But the client needs to know, if you do authentication, the client, of course, needs to know how should it authenticate to the broker. That information has to get to the client.
Authentication against different topics, or just a single one, for example?
No, the authentication is for the connection. The ACLs on the broker side decide whether a particular client, a user or a client ID, may subscribe and or may publish to a particular topic. Okay. Any other questions?
We have 10 minutes left for questions and so on.
Take advantage of it. I'm early. It never happened to me before.
Let's dive a little more into this. The ACLs, is it possible to have clients that use authentication and others that do not?
Absolutely.
In scenario, the Arduino does not use authentication, so it publishes, tries to at least, but the subscribers need to authenticate themselves.
It is possible to have anonymous clients and authenticated clients on the same broker. Yes, that is possible. In particular for the Mosquito broker, which is the one I'm most familiar with, in particular for this broker, yes, it is possible to have anonymous clients and authenticated clients. You will probably, though, want to do it in such a way that anonymous clients may publish to a certain topic branch. So with this example, I hope you can read it from there, sort of, for example, Arduino/hash, yeah? Whereas authenticated clients would probably publish and or subscribe somewhere else. But that is no problem whatsoever. This Mosquito broker that I'm talking to on my laptop does exactly that. It has support. I've configured anonymous clients for certain topics and authenticated clients for other topics. Yeah? No problem. There's a question here. If you ask it, I'll repeat it.
One moment.
Okay. Can you have a broker as a subscriber to another broker?
Yes. Can I have a broker as a subscriber to another broker? Yes. Excuse me if I go back here. That is exactly this. Yeah. Suppose this is our central broker, if we have such a term. And we have another broker configured as a bridge. This broker, here, we can define where the topics come from this point of view, whether they come in, whether they go out, or both. Yeah. So we could have, for example, Arduino/hash in. Host/DC2 out, and important information in both directions. So in this case, this broker would be a subscriber to that one, a publisher to that one, both at the same time. Yeah, any amount of combinations is possible. And that works really, 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 really well. We're currently working on a project which does transmits GPS location information and also other information from vehicles. And these are published to a central broker, and we transfer them in and out to different clients, depending on what device belongs to what client. And that is really absolutely rock solid, rock solid.
I was looking at this.
Excuse me, just a second. Does that answer the question? Okay.
I was looking at this and I was thinking of a way of replacing the passive checks coming to Icinga and stuff. So instead of using that NSEA crap, this would be quite an interesting solution.
To my mind, this is an extremely interesting solution, and I suggested this to Michael Friedrich, I think it was a year, maybe also a year and a half ago. Unfortunately, we never got around to sitting down together with a beverage to actually look at this closely. But when I first started looking or started studying a little bit of MQTT, it was the very first thing that occurred to me, is monitoring. Yeah? Because you just have a, you have like a bus, like a data bus on which all devices, here I'm up, I'm down, my load is, my disk is, my RAM is, whatever. And you have clients on the other hand, in this case would be Icinga, for example, which just pick up this information and do whatever they would do with the information if it had come from another way. Yeah? And then you wouldn't have bottlenecks like things like NSCA that I was using, no? Where it takes up to several seconds for this transmission not only to get through via TCP, but also then it lands in this funny FIFO thing to then also be processed. It takes ages. You saw it. I had to stutter around for a minute or two. Yeah?
And especially because of the other logic of the deciding of if you want to send it once and forget, so shoot and forget, or receive notifications. And so that's also some logic which could be interesting.
And the last will and testament is a very, very interesting feature for that. You have a host that suddenly drops off and it doesn't notify anymore. Yeah, if you're doing passive checks, it doesn't notify anymore because it's not, it won't send you anything. Whereas using MQTT with the last will and testament, you will, as long as the broker is alive, no, we had that question before, you will in any case get this report.
Yeah. For now, for these kind of cases, you use your own stuff and set like nothing received. Or yeah. So, but yeah, this is a hack to some extent.
Good.
Thank you.
Could you pass your microphone to Jan?
Are the information in the broker persistent or only in memory?
The information in the broker is persistent if and only if I configure the broker to actually do persistence. So in Mosquito, I configure the broker and say support persistence, yes, and then it does quite a lot of work. First of all, retained messages, durable messages, are stored to disk. Second of all, there's quite a lot of logic involved in handling the different quality of services. What I didn't mention is every MQTT client also has a client identifier. Now, if I connect to a broker with a client identifier of JP and say, I'm interested in topic Arduino. Yeah? And say, clean session false. That broker will remember me. It will remember my client ID. And for a certain time, configurable, usually in days, weeks, sometimes years, for a certain time, it will remember me. That means that if in the meantime QoS greater zero messages have come in, quality of service one, quality of service two, and I then at a later time come back to this, connect to this broker, say my name is JP, my client ID is JP, and I'm connecting with a clean session false, then I will get these messages as an afterthought. Okay? Very useful for devices that have been offline for a while. And if I can show you outside, we have to stop now, but this OnTracks application does exactly that. We publish, we connect with a fixed client ID per device, which you configure yourself, to our broker, the broker that you have at home. And the device publishes with quality of service too. So even if I'm completely off, yeah, no wireless, no 3G, no nothing, the client will remember these publishes and will send them off. And as soon as you connect to my broker and you authenticate it and I give you this data, you will see my track. You will see where I went. Okay. Yeah. Good. One more question. Time for one more question. No more questions.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much. So.